Welcome back, everybody. For those of you who don't remember, my name is Frank Lociavo, and I'm your instructor. As we continue with our basic introduction into statistics, it looks like our next topic is talking about the distinction between measurement data and categorical data. We will address that issue when we talk about the three critical things you want to think about as you select among all the statistical procedures that we'll learn this semester. Let me show you what I'm talking about. The bottom line is that we're going to learn many different statistical procedures, some of them really simple, like whether to compute a mean, a median, or a mode. And some of them are more complex, like trying to determine if we should do a regression analysis or an analysis of variance. But regardless of the circumstance, in general, we want to consider three primary factors. Let's discuss each of those key factors individually. When trying to determine the most appropriate statistical procedure, the first thing you want to figure out is what type of data are you working with? For the most part, data can be categorized as measurement data or categorical data. Let's talk about measurement data first. Measurement data is also known as quantitative data. In fact, that's what I typically call it. We are literally measuring some quantity. The data is numerical. The data that we collect represents numbers with numerical meaning. Let's go through a couple examples. When we collect data from people, we almost always get various information about who they are. For example, we might ask them what their age is. When we collect data about age, we typically want to know how many years old are you? Well, that data is measurement data. Somebody might be 17 years old. Someone might be 52 years old. Someone might be 36 years old. All of that data, 17, 52, 36, represents measurements of a quantity. This is pretty straightforward, but it's not always 100% clear. So the way that I determine if something is quantitative data is by asking myself, does the number actually represent some amount of something? So if someone says they're 17 years old, does that mean 17 of something? Yes, it means 17 years have elapsed since the person was born. Let's go over a couple more examples from some of the graphics that we'll be looking at later on in the lecture. For example, this one right here. In this particular experiment, we want to see if the temperature of a room has an effect on how much students can learn. So students were put in a comfortable room or in a hot room, and then they were all given the same test. So the data right here represents their performance on the test. The test had 20 questions. If they got one question right, their score is 1. If they got 20 questions right, their score is 20. So it's really straightforward. So we can see that this is measurement data. This is quantitative data. These are numbers with numerical meaning. When I look at this number 12 right there, I can say, does that mean 12 of something? Yes, it means that student answered 12 items correctly. Let's look at an example on another page. In this particular study, a variety of children were measured on two different variables. Let's look at this one right here, the amount of TV violence that they have watched within the past week. And that's measured in terms of hours. So this kid watched 4 hours of violent TV or videos. This kid watched 9 hours of violent TV or videos. We can see that this is measurement data. The data is quantitative. It represents some quantity. It is numerical. We see numbers with numerical meaning. Does this represent 8 of something? Yes, it represents that that person watched 8 hours of violent TV. So there's no reason to make a big deal about it, but that's what measurement data is. And it turns out in our class, we focus quite a bit on measurement data. Most of the analyses that we will talk about are really geared toward measurement data. That said, we don't want to forget about categorical data. And categorical data is really very interesting. Categorical data is often known as qualitative data, or frequency data, or count data. And the reason why we call it that is because we're counting the number of people in categories. We are counting the frequency, the number of people in categories. Let's go over a couple of examples. Remember, when we collect data from people, we usually want to know who those people are. So in addition to asking about their age, we're probably going to ask something about their gender. Researchers used to use limited categories, just like male or female, but now you'll see there are usually more options to select from. Let's look at that example, and you'll understand what I mean about categorical data. You have to essentially place yourself in a category. Are you male? Are you female? Are you transgender? In general, you need to select one category that describes you. So for me, the data that would be collected is the name male. It's just the name of a category. Do you see how there's nothing that we're measuring in terms of a quantity? So when it comes to gender data, it's clearly not measurement data. It's categorical. In the end, I can simply figure out how many people were males, how many people were females, how many people were transgender. In other words, I'm counting the number of people who place themselves in each category. Let's talk about another couple of examples. Think about something like class rank, freshman, sophomore, junior, senior. Do you see how there are no numbers involved there? There's nothing quantitative. There's nothing that I'm measuring in terms of quantity. So ultimately, the data that I'm going to collect is categorical. For any particular student, they might tell me that they're a freshman or a senior or a junior. There's nothing quantitative about that. It's simply the name of a category. If I was doing some marketing research, I might ask you, if you were looking for a new phone today, what type of phone would you buy? And think about the answer that you would give me, the data that I would be collecting. You'd tell me the brand name of a cell phone. So you might say, I would buy an iPhone, or I would buy a Samsung, or I would buy a Google Pixel. Do you see how that data does not involve measuring any quantities? There's nothing numerical about the name iPhone. There's nothing numerical about the name Samsung. Those brand names are simply category names, and in the end, I can simply count how many people selected each category. In other words, I can look at the frequencies to determine which brand seems most popular. So that's the first key piece of information that we want to think about when determining the most appropriate statistical procedure. What type of data are we working with? At that point, we want to ask ourselves a somewhat more sophisticated question. Are you examining differences between groups or relationships between variables? To make that distinction clear, let's first revisit this example right here. Remember, we're trying to determine if the temperature of a room affects learning. So we designed an experiment in which we compared the people in one room, which was comfortable, with the people in another room, which was really very warm. So clearly, in this example, we are trying to compare groups. But we're not always trying to determine if there are differences between groups. Sometimes we're trying to determine, is there a relationship between two variables? So, for example, I might ask this type of question. Is viewing TV violence related to aggressive behavior in children? And if I'm asking that type of research question, it's likely that I'm going to collect data in this way. Specifically, that type of question is often answered using a correlational study. And in a correlational study, we typically measure several variables, in this case we have two, and we want to see how they're related. Think about the word correlational. It essentially consists of co-relation. I want to see if there's a co-relationship between two variables. Do you see here I'm not comparing different groups? I'm just looking at this group of children right here. And for each child, I'm measuring them on two different variables. I want to figure out how many hours of violent video and TV they're watching each week. And for each child, I'm also measuring throughout the day at school how many aggressive behaviors they engage in. And we want to see if there's a relationship between these two variables. As a child watches more violence, are they acting more violently? As kids watch less violence, are they acting less violently? So, the second key factor that we want to consider, are we looking for differences between groups, or are we looking for relationships between variables? We've mentioned groups, we've mentioned variables. It's pretty important to figure out how many groups you're dealing with and how many variables you're dealing with. That's the third key factor you want to consider when trying to decide the most appropriate statistical procedure to carry out. Let's go over a couple of the examples that we've already looked at. First, let me clarify what I mean by a variable. A variable is simply something that we measure that can vary in terms of its value. So let's revisit this example. First of all, how many groups are we comparing? It's very clear that we have two groups. There are people in a comfortable room and people in a hot room. What variables are we working with? There are actually two key variables that we're working with. One variable defines the temperature of the room. So do you see how one room is 70 degrees and one room is 90 degrees? That is something that varies in this experiment. Another variable that we're measuring in this experiment is their performance on the test that they took. So in this example, we can see that we have two groups and two variables that we're dealing with. In this particular case, when we're dealing with an experimental study, those variables actually have some special names that we use. The temperature of the room in this case is what we call an independent variable, and their performance on the test that they took is called the dependent variable. We will talk about the variable names for an experimental study in more detail in a later lecture. But overall, we essentially know everything that we need to know now about this particular example. We know that we're dealing with measurement data, we know that we have two groups that we're comparing, and we know that we're dealing with an independent variable and a dependent variable. In this situation, we'd be conducting what we call an independent samples t-test to see if there are differences between those two groups. That's something that we're going to learn later on this semester. For now, I just want to get you thinking about some of the important things that we need to pay attention to so that we can determine which test is most appropriate. Let's get a little bit more practice with this third key factor. How many groups and how many variables are you working with? Let's go through one more example. In this particular example, we're trying to determine which dosage level best helps schizophrenic patients concentrate and focus on reality. Once we find that some medication is effective, we have to determine how much medication to give them. We don't want to give them too much because remember, all medications have some type of side effect. So as we just kind of casually look at this and we try to determine how many groups are being compared, it's pretty easy to see we have one group of patients receiving 10 milligrams of this drug, another group of patients receiving 100 milligrams of this drug, and a third group of patients receiving 500 milligrams of this drug. So we clearly have three groups that we're comparing. Well, let's ask that related question, how many variables are we actually dealing with? This is another experimental type of study where one variable that we have essentially defines the groups, and that's the independent variable. So you see how we're varying how much of the medication they're receiving. These people receive 10 milligrams, these people 100, these people 500. So that's one variable that we're dealing with, the level of medication. Another variable that we're looking at is how well did these patients perform when we assessed how well they were able to concentrate and focus on reality. So for now, let's just call those concentration scores. Every single one of these patients, no matter which group they were in, has a concentration score. You might recall we called that a dependent variable. So we have three different groups and two different variables, an independent variable that defines how much medication they're receiving, and a dependent variable, which represents how well they're able to concentrate. In this situation where we want to compare three groups, we would need to conduct an analysis of variance, which is also known as an ANOVA. It's an awesome statistical procedure. You're going to love it, and you're going to learn it later this semester. In fact, you're going to learn a lot of different statistical procedures. This right here is what we call a decision tree. It shows a lot of the different statistical procedures that we'll be learning this semester. And I know you're not familiar with any of those procedures right now, but I just want you to see that we have an organized way that will allow us to determine which procedure is most appropriate. And this decision tree uses those three key factors that I just taught you about. It starts with asking you, hey, what kind of data do you have? Is your data categorical or is your data measurement? And then at that point, it asks you, what type of question are you asking? Are you looking for relationships between variables or are you looking for differences between groups? If you're looking for differences between groups, how many groups do you have? Do you have two groups that you're comparing or more? Using a decision tree like that, it will become very easy for us to determine the most appropriate statistical analysis for our data. Well, I think that's enough for us to cover right now. We have a lot to look forward to this semester. I hope you enjoyed this basic introduction to statistics. I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.